Good evening, I'm Amaya and welcome to another edition of Going Public, a show that traces the journey a private company takes in transforming itself into a publicly listed company on the Colombo Stock Exchange. As usual, on today's show we will be dissecting the moves of another industry leader who has made this transition into a public company, not only a smooth one but a successful one as well. This is a joint initiative between the Securities and Exchange Commission of Sri Lanka, the Colombo Stock Exchange, as well as MTV Sports. And on that note, I'll hand you over to your host of the day, Mr. Vasula Premavardhana, who is the former director of the Securities and Exchange Commission, as well as a capital market expert. Over to you, Vasula.
Thank you, Amaya. Welcome to Going Public, where we discuss with entrepreneurs and companies who have successfully done just that. And here today to talk about their success story is a company that needs no introduction. It's Mr. Vegapitiya, chairman of LAFS, and Mr. Sarath De Silva, who is the general manager of Special Projects. Welcome to Going Public. Welcome to Sarath De Silva. Mr. Vegapitiya, to start at the beginning, tell me, what's the story behind LAFS?
LAFS was started as a tiny little enterprise in 1995, focusing to enter into the energy sector of this country. In 1995, at the time we managed to enter into the energy sector, it was a very highly volatile situation as a result of the broader socio-economic and political environment of this country. The energy sector was basically in the hands of multinational foreign companies. Politically and socially, we were a disturbed nation as a result of 30 years of the disruption. So we found the entry looking at long-term prospects, and we slowly managed to enter into the energy sector, which is globally recognized as highly volatile, highly competitive, which is mainly dominated by oil major companies or state-owned companies. Today, that tiny little company that we started in 1995 has become a public listed company owned by the public of this country. So we are very proud that little enterprise that we created have generated wealth, created value, and share it with ordinary people of this country.
So what you're saying is starting at very small beginnings in 1995, by within what, 15 years, you have built it to a very large company, which is listed. Just to ask basic questions first, when you decided to go to list, to public, what was your compelling reason?
The main reason that compelled us to list the company was our future, securing the future. Normally, if you look at most of the enterprises like us, which normally initiated by either entrepreneurs like me or set of people who are willing to take the risk, who can see things that others can't see, identifying opportunities, bearing the risk, they start. They find the entry point and then slowly they grow with various challenges and obstacles and understanding the macro business environments, they slowly grow. The enterprise will grow together with the life cycle of the entrepreneur. And at a certain point, if you do not manage to separate the enterprise and the entrepreneur, then the sustainability on the long run has a great doubt. So what we wanted to do is, as a truly Sri Lankan organization, which want to grow and sustain, we wanted to introduce a lot of disciplines into the organization. And we have seen a lot of Sri Lankan examples where the person who initiated, who started the business, failed to transform the organization or take it into the next level. And along with his life cycle, sometimes he hand over the business to his next generation, or he fails to take it to the next level, and then it becomes a family business. So what we wanted from the early days, to make it as a long, sustainably growing Sri Lankan enterprise, which can be one day become a global company. Right. So we recognize certain prerequisites. Firstly, we need to have professional management to be embedded into the system. We want to separate individualism and the organization. Then we need to have a lot of disciplines in various sectors, include financial discipline, management disciplines, like that. So therefore, when looking at various options, we felt that taking our company and listing in the Colombo Stock Exchange would be the most ideal option we have. So that's why we decided to do that. And also, there was another reason. We wanted to broad-base the ownership. Even though the original investors were few, we wanted to create certain wealth and then share it with our ordinary Sri Lankans. So from the early days, we were very nation-minded organization, where we wanted to share the golden harvest that we created with ordinary people of this country. So those are the main reasons. In addition to that, there were other business reasons, financial reasons. In the beginning, when we started as a very little small enterprise, the capital was one of our constraints. For us to grow, we wanted a lot of large amount of fresh capital. Energy business is globally known as a highly capital intensive business. So therefore, we were looking at various options. At that time, borrowing from the ordinary financial market was very expensive. We had borrowed a lot of additional capital required for the expansion, but we realized for us to grow in a more steady pace, we need to have other options to explore. So those are the main reasons which compelled us to look at listing of our company in the Colombo Stock Exchange.
So obviously the decision to list was a decision that you made a while ago, was it? As you were starting up, or as the company started to grow, you decided it's better for the company to be listed. But at what point did you decide that this is the time to list?
Well, we knew that we looked at the macro socio and political environment of this country. We knew that looking at the regional level, almost all the countries in the Asian region was growing. They economically growing. We are next to one of the fastest growing economies in the world, India. And on the other hand, we have China. Most of the Asian countries were growing. Unfortunately, we could not do it due to some internal problems, we all know. So we knew this problem could not continue forever. There will be time that we will find the solution. We were very futuristic. We recognize sooner or later this is going to be over. We have to get ready. And so we planned it. And then same time, the financial market was also very promising. New companies were coming for listing. There were additional funds available. Retailers were very enthusiastic. So we felt that we want to do it. But you can't do it overnight. Before we actually list the company, at least 2 years prior to how it happened, we got ourselves ready. A lot of homework we had to do.
Had to be done.
Introducing proper management system. We had all the systems in place, but we had to discipline within our organization before listing the company.
I think we have to go in for a break right now. Welcome back to Going Public, and we are here with Mr. Vega Pitia and Mr. Sarath De Silva to talk about the exciting story of Laughs and their experience in going public or getting listed in the Colombo Stock Exchange. Mr. Vega Pitia, you were saying that you wanted to go public or listed in Colombo Stock Exchange for various reasons, some of which were the discipline that you wanted to introduce and the processes. Can you elaborate a little bit on that?
Well, for a company to sustainably grow, I always emphasize sustainably grow, because these are very important element on long-term basis. We need to make sure certain disciplines are being implemented within various sectors of the organization. Otherwise, we usually see that in Sri Lanka, mostly Sri Lankan enterprises, the person who start the business, when he gradually grow the organization, they mix up with lot of personal complacencies. Mm-hmm. But from the early stage of from the inception of our organization, we wanted to have best practices within the organization in terms of our overall strategic planning, financial management, operations, marketing, and human resource management, etc. So, one of the key reason that we want to list the organization or company in the Colombo Stock Exchange, we will be compelled to do that, because there will be a lot of outsiders, there are a lot of regulators looking at us. Even though we do not want it from a legal perspective, we ourselves wanted to introduce all these good practices into the organization. Mm-hmm. So that was one reason we felt that listing would improve our disciplines within the organization. Today, after almost 2 years, 2.5 or 3 years after listing our organization, company, we believe that we managed to achieve that objective of listing the company in the Colombo Stock Exchange.
Right. Mr. De Silva, you have anything to add to that?
When he says about discipline, the whole business processes were revisited prior to IPO, and also various governance issues were addressed, mm-hmm. and accountability and disclosure elements all were addressed before that. And as he said, it was very helpful in the long run. Now, after 3 years of operation after IPO, mm-hmm. it has proved useful in making the organization and in achievement of their goals and objectives.
What were the new divisions or new setups that you had to focus on going into the phase of doing the listing, the actual process of listing, plus post-listing for investor relation management and so on and so forth?
Well, as he said, about 2 years before he was planning to go for IPO, we appointed an independent consultant to advise us on various issues, and special focus was made on accounting and finances. And also, along with the consultant, we had the facility of using one of the big three firm of chartered accountants here to go through our past financials and advise us what to do and to clean up the balance sheets of the main company, the Laugh Gas, and four other subsidiaries. And also the consultant and the company was helping us in a big way to make the correct forecast for 5 years downwards and do the proper business valuation, and that is very important and that is fundamental when you go public. And all that was done with the help of the consultant and the other company that we hired, and it was successfully, by the time that we are ready, it was all processes were looked at, mm-hmm. and it was very helpful in going public and making it a successful IPO.
Right.
That's good. Just to add what Sarath mentioned, it was our first experience. It was a very interesting experience. That's why it took almost maybe 1.5 years to get ourselves organized internally. But today, with the discipline and experience that we have, we can do it within 6 months.
Right.
So we were very careful. Mm-hmm. At the very first attempt, we were learning. Even though we would have completed within maybe 6 to 7 months, we wanted all the stakeholders in our organization to understand this changing culture. Everyone should be aligned towards that broader goal. Also, the change we wanted to do gradually, not a drastic change overnight. So that's why it took that. But if any company who has all these professional management systems in place, it takes less than 6 months to list in the Columbus Stock Exchange.
Yeah. Obviously, yours was a very planned entry. From the vision of the company itself, it seems that you wanted to be a company that went public, as opposed to some entrepreneurs do have companies which they are entrepreneurial and they want their company, and they somewhere down the line they decide, okay, why not go public? So obviously you had a little bit more structured approach to this. But what would you suggest to people who may have a similar situation and they want to go public? Where should the process begin first?
According to the Registrar of Companies, I think we have close upon to 50,000 businesses are registered. I think if you take NGOs and few other companies out, I think we have about 20,000 operating companies in Sri Lanka. But I think less than 200 companies are listed in the Colombo Stock Exchange. Why? Most of them do not know the benefits, do not know the advantages. So therefore, if they really do understand the benefits, what are the advantages that they can enjoy, I am sure they will surely convince to list or broad-base their ownership. There are a lot of wrong perceptions, myths among the Sri Lankan entrepreneurs of listing companies. I think these kind of efforts, especially to sharing experience, how a company can be listed, what are the advantages and disadvantages, would surely encourage a lot of Sri Lankan companies to use this advantage. I think in that sense, these kind of discussions are very useful.
Certainly. What are the advantages that you think you have identified?
Firstly, you will separate the organization or enterprise and the entrepreneur, which has to happen. Otherwise, there is always a doubt about the future. You need to separate the entity from the person who create that, and it should survive. Now, we all going to die one day, and we have a life cycle. But if you have the ability to transform the organization into a different level, a self-sustained entity, then you can expect a long-lasting journey. Mm-hmm. And that's the most important advantage. Otherwise, once you hand over the organization to maybe next generation, you are not too sure about the continuity.
Yes,
that's number one. Secondly, you will understand the real value of what you created. A lot of companies entrepreneurs, they start in a small way, they manage the business, they grow, they do not know the real value that they created. So you can measure how much wealth that you created for yourself and for the society. So your company can be from a financial point of view, exactly what kind
quantified.
Of wealth you create.
You can quantify.
Thirdly, you have the access to cost-free capital. One of the biggest constraints for the growth, especially in the Sri Lankan the environment, is the access to capital. Now, when you list the organization, there are various types of listing, introduction, and various kind of thing. I think you can easily raise funds from the public, and that's one of the key important mm-hmm. things. Also, you will have a your image building kind of a thing. The people will recognize. You will be able to position your organization in a totally different mm-hmm. Perspective. So these are some of the advantages that we enjoy right now.
I think it's time to go in for another break, and we'll be back to continue the story of Lars. Welcome back to Going Public. Picking up where we left off, Mr. De Silva, anything else that you may want to add as advantages to going public in your experience?
As you said, the access to capital was the main thing, and also the broad basing of the ownership and segregating the individual entrepreneur from the main company. In addition, I would say we created a brand value, additional brand value after going public. Now, in the financial statements, the tangibles are reflected in any way, the land, buildings, and all the assets, all these receivables, all that.
That's right.
And more than that, there are intangibles that has to be reflected for the company's benefit, and that is really things like brand image,
goodwill,
technology, patents. So the difference between the gap, when you say gap, that is reflected on the share price, reflecting the stock exchange, our book values, are the results of the values of the intangibles. And out of the intangibles, the brand value is, we have seen that the brand value has gone up after going into IPO.
Mm-hmm.
And this is also reflected with the views expressed by various stakeholders of ours, maybe customers, suppliers, various kinds of people that we interact almost daily. And we have created some confidence in them before going into IPO. And they have recognized the fact that publicly listed company is always safer, and they were confident in dealing with us.
So both nationally and internationally. Does that reflect in your sales, for example?
That's
you
right.
See that has actually
we
affected.
We have grown in our volumes of sale
mm-hmm.
Quite significantly after IPO.
Right.
And you know, not only the sales, and every other indicators have gone up very significantly after we went into the IPO.
So basically the confidence of the public has increased in your product as much as, you know, the company itself.
Exactly.
Right. And how about any concerns, for example, loss of control, like what you mentioned, the myths of going public, if you can address that.
Well, we used to interact with a lot of Sri Lankan entrepreneurs. They always wanted to understand how we did that, and whether they also can do it.
Mm-hmm.
So usual issues or concern they raise is that there will be someone coming and taking over the company, so losing the control.
Mm-hmm.
I personally believe there's nothing like that. Of course, you have certain mechanism.
Mm-hmm.
You can decide what percentage of equity you are going to dispose or give it to the public. But in our case, we never worried about that factor,
mm-hmm.
because if there's anyone else who can manage it better than me,
yes.
Why not?
Huh?
Mm-hmm. So as long as he create additional wealth or value,
yes,
like that. So losing control, of course, it's a myth. There are various
methods,
mechanisms. There are methods to protect the mm-hmm. owners. Control.
Mm-hmm.
But the reason why these kind of wrong perceptions came was recently there were certain acquisitions, indirect kind of a controlling things in certain companies. But by and large, I don't think that it's a concern that someone should have mm-hmm. before listing in the Colombo Stock Exchange. Also, certain people are very much concerned that outsiders will tell you how to manage the business. Mm-hmm. Say, for example, there are a lot of regulators, especially Colombo Stock Exchange, Securities mm-hmm. and Exchange Commissions, are monitoring your performance, how you do it. And you have certain regulatory compliance requirements where you have to have AGMs, you have to do your periodical audits and dividend policies, etc., etc. I think from a positive angle, these are good things that an organization should implement, whether it is a public quoted company or a private company, for their future progress. All these things should be there. Now, people were talking about the negative aspects. Our experience is there was only one negative aspect, is that we lost a little bit of our democratic right, you know, of talking. You know, before we talk to the public, we have to think twice whether right. that information has price sensitivity or something like that. Those days when we gather at corporate events, we are free to talk anything. When we meet journalists,
right.
we are free to talk. But now we have to be very mindful,
right.
with the, especially with regard to our future plans, mm-hmm. what we are going to do. Before disclosing to the Colombo Stock Exchange, we should not talk to anyone else. Mm-hmm. That was the only negative negative impact. Mm-hmm. We normally, as entrepreneurs, love to talk about what we are going to do.
Yeah.
So that has been little bit, you know, controlled.
Curtailed, yes.
In a way, it's good. We discipline ourselves.
Right.
Other than that, I think all the other things are positive, mm-hmm. Very encouraging things.
In addition to what Chairman said, we had to, unlike those days before prior to IPO, we had to deal with 22,000 shareholders, and we had to address their concerns. We had to continuously interact with them, and especially at the AGMs, we do not suppress their views. We have given the maximum possible time to address their concerns, and it is the way how to handle the minority shareholders. And also, even in the among the minority shareholders, we can find quality shareholders having their intention to stay with the company for a long time, quality shareholders, and those are the people that we are generally looking for, sustainable growth, those who stay with us to share the golden harvest, as we mm-hmm. because only problem is, as he said, we are constrained to talk about it. Even inside the company, people are very scared and constrained to talk to each other, even some of the plans, rather than going and talking out in the public. Even inside the offices or the organization, people are in a way it's discipline, and also we are constrained to talk about very much of our future plans and development
right.
plans and etc.
Talking of managing investor relations and expectations, how do you all handle the issue, for example, when it was privately held, how much you all made was your business, in the sense, and if you lost, it's still your business, it's your money. When you go public and you list a company, of course, some of that part is also public's money. So how do you address their concerns of, you know, earnings, share prices, as you manage the company? How do you separate those two, or do you separate those two?
In the case of Laugh Gas IPO, to the true meaning of public listing, we had the largest number of applications in the recent past. I believe we had over 60,000 applications from the ordinary people asking our shares. We had almost 5,000 application from north and east. So we always, when we were making our policy of allotting shares, mm-hmm. we gave the priority to small applications. And At Last Gas PLC, we do not have minority shareholders. Mm-hmm. All the shareholders have equal rights. I think if you come to our AGMs, unlike other usual AGMs that you see in the corporate sector in Sri Lanka, we give them enough freedom to go through our finances, ask any question, criticize us, give new suggestions. Fortunately, we have been maintaining a good dividend policy. We have been increasing our revenue, profitability. We have been creating additional wealth to all the shareholders. Therefore, there were no single reason for our shareholders to worry. So therefore, in the case of Laugh Gas PLC, we do not treat them as minority shareholders. So they also equally have the right to question us. They can walk into our office or to any of our branches at any time and inquire what's happening, and they can give a lot of suggestions, mm-hmm. like that.
Right. So as far as the earnings and the you don't feel extra pressure now that you're somewhat answering to the public also towards increasing your earnings, or do you just go about your business making sure the company is doing well and then the share price takes care of itself?
At the time of when we listing, we gave them certain prospects. We told them our future plans. We have been managing the same way as we portrayed, as we planned. We have been continuously maintaining growth in revenue, profits, earning per share, with the dividends, all what they expect. Therefore, there was no pressure. Within our organization, we have a pressure to deliver more. I think from that sense, our shareholders are very happy, which we can prove at the time when we have annual general meetings.
Mm-hmm. Right.
The support and the enthusiasm that they...
It's reflected in the audience. Yeah. Brilliant. It's time to go for another break and we'll be back soon. Welcome back to Going Public. Mr. Lagapitiya, we were discussing the processes and the involvement in the IPO process. How important is the roadshow in this IPO process?
Well, if you can find buyers to buy, subscribe your shares within the country, is very much sufficient. But in our case, we thought now, since we are one of the unique businesses, ventures that listed in the Colombo Stock Exchange in the recent past, being in the energy business, which is regarded as a global business, we thought of attracting foreign investors, foreign shareholders. So therefore, we had three roadshows, one in Malaysia, one in Singapore and Dubai. There we wanted to bring foreign investors into the country, as we know that for the economic growth we need foreign direct investments, not only in fresh new projects but also the public listing efforts like this. Therefore, we had three road shows which were supported by our investment advisors and brokering companies. It was a very successful road shows, and there were a lot of enthusiasm shown, and actually there were a lot of applications from foreign investors as well. So I think for newcomers, they should try to keep this kind of road shows in relevant markets.
Right.
like in the regional markets or wherever it is right. suitable,
right.
it will attract foreign investors. Mm-hmm.
And foreign institutional investors. I think Mr. De Silva also brought up this topic of the investors that you know wants to stay with you. How do you actually decide? Because once you are listed, you know anybody can buy your share. But how do you? What do you mean by that? The type of investors.
Now when you say high quality investors, they will be looking at two aspects: the qualitative and also quantitative. As far as the quantitative are concerned, is the supernormal growth and the product demand, and not only the EPS but ROE, ROE, everything. And also more than the quantitative ones, it's a qualitative, especially where they're looking into the people, the founders of the company. They wanted the founders or the pioneers, the promoters of the company should stay with the company. And it was there with us, and that became a major strength to go for high quality investors who will stay longer with us. Mm-hmm. And also they look for innovation, and they also look for the bold initiatives that they have taken in the past. And those helped us to canvas and get their support to invest with us on a long-term basis. And that was there amply in our organization to satisfy both qualitatively and quantitatively the high-quality investors who will stay longer in the company. All the ingredients were there, mm-hmm. and for them to invest. And we got hold of several important stakeholders into the company as shareholders who will stay with us for a longer.
What are the opportunities other than what you mentioned, like brand image and you know going to the market for capital? Any other advantages from foreign investors coming in to your company?
The business that we are in is a global business. The energy business is a global business. So therefore, they all understand the fundamentals of this business, whether the energy business is in Sri Lanka or some other country, the same industry fundamentals apply, and the global fundamentals are equally applied and effect to the future growth. So therefore it's very easy to attract foreign investors. And from the time that, I mean, even prior to our listing, there were propositions from various oil major companies, global oil major companies, to join hand with us, to become shareholders. But as a Sri Lankan company, we wanted to maintain our local identity. Therefore, even though there were various propositions to join hand with us, we kept that. We rather preferred to have Sri Lankan shareholders than foreigners. Even now, there were a lot of inquiries to buy our shares. The only event that we entertained such request was from the EPF. It's again people's money. They wanted to buy a stake a few years ago. So we gave them the chance to buy that. Other than that, we have never allowed foreign investors to directly buy a large quantity of shares. But with our future growth, we are planning to look at that macro level. As I mentioned, certain plans that we are going to implement cannot be disclosed now. But if you look at the regional level, especially our Sri Lankan economic outlook being going to develop as an energy hub, especially there are oil exploration and gas explorations going to happen. That will surely make a major impact to the energy business of this country. There will be upstream activities taking place, there will be downstream activities taking place, and there were new investments surely coming in, because in the energy value chain you need to have a lot of partners. I think within next 5 to 10 years time there will be a tremendous growth in all energy sectors. In addition to that, in our country, per capita energy consumption is relatively low compared to most of the other Asian countries, especially in terms of LPG. That's our major primary source of energy used by cooking purposes and other heating purposes. Sri Lanka energy per capita LPG consumption is very low compared to other Asian countries. So we know that with the increase of per capita income from maybe 2,500 to 4,000, changing of lifestyle, there will be a tremendous growth potential within the country. Mm-hmm. And also that will open up entry point to the regional markets as well. So these are the, you know, indirectly I wanted to tell you, from an industry perspective, there will be a lot of potential. Surely our shareholders will ultimately get the benefit.
Of course, you seem to be well rooted locally, but you seem to have your eyes on the global market as well. And you're obviously a very highly proponent of listing, going public. So can we expect more subsidiaries to come out in the market as, of course, if you're allowed to disclose these things, your future plans, will you be bringing out new companies to the public and let the public share your, you know?
Labs is a group of companies. We have almost 20 companies within the group. Actually, best thing yet to come. We have almost planned a few more companies. Mm-hmm. We are ready to do it. I think within very short period of time, we are planning to list a few more companies. Mm-hmm. One day we want to list almost all the companies.
Fantastic.
Because we now enjoy the benefits. Mm-hmm. And it's not a business secret. Mm-hmm. But we are enormously benefited as a result of listing our first company.
Mr. De Silva, maybe you can add more to what Mr. Venkatapiya said.
Yes, as you said, we have lined up few companies to be listed in the short to medium term. And a lot of people will be asking, is it the right time to list the company to go in public? And we believe the time is right because we see the interest rates are falling. And also there will be a growth, substantial growth in the private sector credit. And especially it's the IPO level that the fundamentals are taken into account more than in the general capital market operations. So if your fundamentals are correct in the subsidiary that we are listing, we have no issue and confident that it will be a successful listing of those companies as well. And more than the market sentiments, you have to be bold and brave to take that type of initiative, and we have proved ourselves in that. And especially because I can cite an example where when before we go into the IPO, we had issue with regard to certain treatment, accounting treatment in our financials, where auditors have expressed their concern, but we took that challenge and went into UITF of the Institute of Chartered Accountants and got our, you know, application certified. Mm-hmm. And that is how we had to face. And if you have confidence in what you do, there is no reason why we should fail.
Brilliant. I'm sure you won't. And the whole of the public is waiting for your other companies and obviously for future success of RAF PLC. Unfortunately, it's time to wrap up our show. And I want to thank Mr. Venkatapiya and Mr. Sarath De Silva for taking time off their busy schedule to be with us. And over to Maya, thank you very much for being with us today.
Thank you, Vasula. And there you go, another bold and brave, true Sri Lankan company who have taken their company to greater heights by going public. And we hope that you enjoyed this edition of our program. Do join us again next week for another great episode. Till then, take care.